all those who are watching us both home and abroad, we ask that your presence will touch every man, every woman who be under the sound of this sinful voice. Lord, you ask us that we should ask. So this evening, we ask for healing. We ask for anointing. We ask for liberation. We ask that you do something unspectacular, unknown to us, in the life of somebody. Let there be a miracle. If there is somebody who needs a job, provide a job in the name of Jesus. If there is somebody who wants the seat of the womb, begin to touch a woman's womb. Begin to touch a man's loin. Lord, do something in the life of somebody. Now tonight, may they not hear my sinful voice. May they hear the voice of Jesus Christ. Not I, but Christ. Be honored, loved, and exalted. Not I, but Christ. Be seen, be known, and be heard. Not I, but Christ. In every look and action. Not I, but Christ. In every thought and word. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You can be seated. I welcome you all to this Bible Prophecy Seminar, which we dub the Untold Truth. I welcome all our audience online, all our audience here, those who listen to us via different media's format. We want to welcome you to this evening's program. Today is day 3 and we are here again. But as I always do, it was Jesus himself who said, if you continue in my words, then you are my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. If the Son sets you free, you shall be free indeed. Will you say an amen there? Amen. I want to make to you 5 promises. Promise number 1 is the Bible is going to be the bedrock of our study. And the reason is the Bible means what it says and says what it means. Promise number 2 is you shall be enlightened irrespective of who you are. Promise number 3 is you shall be challenged to make the most important decision of your life. And promise number 4 is those who love the Lord, they will be baptized. And the 5th promise is your life will never be the same. I again welcome you as a means of recap. Yesterday night we dealt with the topic, we christened the untold truth. About the truth, the untold truth about the truth. We made the point that the book of Revelation is a book about Jesus Christ. It's a book that reveals Jesus in his godly state. And we use Revelation 1 verse 1, which says the revelation of Jesus Christ which God gave him to show to his servant things which must shortly take place, and he sent and signified it by his angel to his servant John. And we made the point that the book is about PPF. It's a book that deals with the past. It's a book that deals with the present. And it's a book that deals with the future. Revelation 1 verse 19 says, write the things which you have seen, and the things which are, and the things which will take place after these things. So we said yesterday that this book will deal with our yesterday, it will deal with our today, and it will deal with our tomorrow. And we look at Jesus in his divinity. And that is when we said that he says, I am the Alpha and the Omega. What I want you again to understand is that when Jesus said in Revelation 1 verse 8 that he is the Alpha and the Omega, it means he doesn't have a beginning and he doesn't have an end. He himself is whatever that existed to be beginning. As far back as God lives, that is his beginning. And John saw him in his godly state, and he was like a dead man. We saw yesterday also that the revelation deals with the creatorship of God. When he speaks about Jesus, the faithful witness, the beginning of the creation of God, and we explain that it means the source. It means he is the cause of creation. We again saw yesterday that Revelation deals with his messiahship. It deals with not just that his sacrifice. It deals with Jesus's unique principle whereby he deserves our worship. If he's a God, if he's a creator, if he's a sustainer of life, then he deserves our worship. And we ended yesterday when we said he's a victorious commander. And there, Pilate asked a question, and Jesus attempted answering. And Pilate asked the saddest question I've ever heard in my life. Truth was in front of him, and Pilate asked, "What is truth?" The untold truth about the truth. For tonight, our caption is Unmasking the Masked Enemy. Repetitive though. Unmasking the Masked Enemy. Initially, I want to christen it Unmasking the Masked. But tonight, we will look at it Unmasking the Masked Enemy. Unmasking the Masked Enemy. Do you know who is your enemy? Are you aware what he stands for? Do you know what he intends to do with your life? The book of Revelation is going to deal with this in a very unique way. Point number one, when you want to understand the book of Revelation, you need to also understand the book of Genesis. What do I mean? Revelation is the Omega of the Bible, and Genesis is the Alpha of the Bible. The book of beginning and the book of ending, these two books, Satan hates them. Why? The book of Genesis tells us our origin. We are not from ape. We are not by accident. We are not created by any other thing. The book of Genesis says God is our creator. And in the book of Revelation, he makes the point he deserves our worship. So Satan gets these two books. So he attacks it from various angles. I want to make some point to anchor these. Point number one. You see, in the book of Genesis, curse was pronounced on humanity. Genesis 3 verse 14 and verse 17. But in the book of Revelation, chapter 22 verse 3, there was no more curse on humanity. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm here to announce tonight, in the book of Genesis, death entered the world. Genesis 3 verse 19. In the book of Revelation, death was extinct. Revelation 21 verse 4. In the book of Genesis, man was driven out of his Edenic home. Genesis 3 verse 24. In the book of Revelation, Revelation 22 verse 1 to 21, man will restore back to his Edenic home. In the book of Genesis, the tree of life were guarded by, or was guarded by, holy angels. Genesis 3 verse 24. And in the book of Omega, the right to the tree of life were restored back to man. Genesis 22 verse 14. In the book of Genesis, sorrow and suffering, pain, entered into the world. Genesis 3 verse 17 to verse 19. But in the book of Revelation, Revelation 21 verse 4, there was no more sorrow, there was no more tear, there was no more crying. In the book of Genesis, ladies and gentlemen, Nimrod founded the Babylonian system that was contrary to God. I will expatiate on this in the days ahead. In the book of Revelation, Babylonian system of denominalization of the world was destroyed. Where Babel, false worship with their prophet, they were destroyed. In Revelation chapter 13 and verse chapter 17. In the book of Genesis, Genesis 2 verse 18 through 24, there was a marriage of the first Adam. In Revelation 19 verse 1 to 9, there was a marriage of the last Adam. Will you not say an amen there? Amen. Ladies and gentlemen, in the book of Genesis, man's dominion of earth ceases and Satan's dominion begins. Genesis 3 verse 24. But in the book of Revelation, Satan's dominion over our universe ceases and the sons of God have dominion and they were restored by. In the book of Genesis, the old serpent, Satan, the dragon, who causes the whole world to sin with suffering and with death, he was introduced. Genesis 3 verse 1. But in the book of Revelation chapter 20 verse 1 to verse 3, the old serpent, Satan, the dragon, was bound for 1,000 years. Lastly, in the book of Genesis, doom of the old serpent was pronounced. The first gospel in Genesis 3 verse 15. Yet in the book of Revelation, the doom of the old serpent was executed. Genesis 20 verse 10. Will somebody not say an amen there? And masking the masked enemy, pardon for the typographical error, and masking the mask enemy. We want to know who Satan is. If you ask a much simpler a caption, I will say, why so much suffering? Or I will have asked, good God, bad world, why? Why are Nigerians shouting God, God, yet there are problems in the land? Why are Africans so religious, yet there are problems in the land? Why is the world claiming to love God, yet there is problem in the land? I want you to join me. Before our world entered the challenge that we currently see, join me as we go beyond the center of the universe. We are going to pass the galaxies. We will move down into deep space. And there we will get into a place called heaven. There we see the battle for God's own throne. Revelation chapter 12 verse 7. Listen carefully. The Bible says, and I want you to follow me microscopically, and war broke out in heaven. Michael and his angels, they fought with the dragon. Prefix with a definite article. Michael and his angels fought with the dragon, and the dragon and his angels, they also fought. There was war. Some say it was a psychological war. It was a battle of ideas. Whatever war it was, there was a context between two different group of people. In this heaven or cosmic conflict that started from God's own heaven, there was no middle ground. Everyone in heaven was enlisted to follow one of these leaders, Satan, at that time Lucifer, or to follow God. So two group of people. In heaven, there was a need for angels to make a decision for their lives. Ladies and gentlemen, evidently, one third of the angels, they fought against the Creator. Just as we are also in this world today, somebody, some boy, some girl, some woman, some man must make a decision in this great controversy, in this fight between good and evil. There is no middle ground. So there was war. There was war, but there is a good news. Verse 8 says, but praise God for the but of Revelation 12 verse 8. He said, but they did not prevail. I am here to announce by the authority of God's word, whenever there is a battle between God and the enemy is always the loser. Won't you say amen there? Amen. He will lose
in your life. He will lose in your business. He will lose in your academy. He will lose in your marriage. He will lose everything that you align yourself with God. When Satan comes at war, he will lose. Why the war? War broke out in God's own heaven. Ladies and gentlemen, the point must be made. Satan is anti-peace personality. He hates peace. Heaven experienced complete tranquility. Heaven was a place of joy. Angels were singing, "Holy, holy." It was a peaceful place. But Satan, who was called Lucifer, from two Latin words put together, lux and ferro, which means he that beareth light, or the light bearer. Why was there a war? Ladies and gentlemen, the Bible gave us a hint in Ezekiel. In Bible study, Bible must unlock itself. You use the Bible to unlock other Bible verses. Ezekiel 28, verse 12 and verse 14, talking about Lucifer. You were the model of perfection. You were full of wisdom, a perfect angel, and in beauty you were in Eden, the garden of God. Was just that the reason? Every precious stone was used to adorn you. You were anointed as a guardian cherub. So I ordained you. This is God speaking. He says no angel was as equal with Satan. He was the highest of all the creatures in God's own heaven. Looking at his status, looking at who he was, looking at the beauty that comes with it, I want to announce today, if you are a beautiful gentleman, you better watch out. If you are a beautiful lady, you better watch out. There is a danger for those who are gifted in beauty, in talent, in speech, whatsoever. You must watch out. Will you say amen there? So the Bible said in Isaiah 14, why did Satan rebel? He says, for you have said in your heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will be like the Most High. Like, seriously? A creature now attempting to be like a creator? Listen, be very careful when you have friends who do the I-ism in God. I-ism. Why do we have political instability? I. Why do we have corruption? I. Why do we have immorality? I. Why do we have sin? I. At the heart of sin, in the middle of S, I, N, is the fundamental reason. May I gratify my eye? May I satisfy my eye? So Lucifer, he said in his heart, be careful the amount of I in your actions and in actions. Ladies and gentlemen, Bible says, so therefore, when we see war, when we see pain, when we see disturbances, when we see corruption, when we see evil in the world today, it started in God's own heaven. When children are made, you ask the question, what was this boy's cry? This is wickedness to its apogee. Strong men in the city of Kigali were made churches in Liberia. Look at Rwanda. Ladies and gentlemen, men and women were crying that my cry is my cry. Why do we have such a distorted society? At the heart of it is I. And who is the founder of I? Lucifer. Unmasking the masked enemy. But the text says, Michael and his angels, they fought against the dragon. Michael means one like God. Ladies and gentlemen, the Bible have instances. He says, but they did not prevail. Jesus is represented as a conquering general. Whenever God is at war, to stand for his people, to help people, to be able to defeat the works of the enemy, he is paraded in the language under the name Michael. Let me give you some biblical instances. You see, the Bible indicates that four times Michael was mentioned. How do we know? The Bible gave us a hint, Revelation 12 verse 7, and we read it. It says, when the war broke out, there were two group of people, Michael, and we also have the dragon. Jude 9 has only one chapter. So Jude 9, it says, and I go, yet Michael, the archangel, the chief of staff of the angels, when contending with the devil, he disputed about the body of Moses, does not bring against him railing accusation, but he said, the Lord rebuke you. We again have Michael. Take note. In Revelation chapter 12 verse 7, Michael went to fight Lucifer. In Jude 9, he contended, and they describe him with another description, the archangel. Michael is the leader of the entire host of angels in heaven. Michael fighting over the body of Moses. Who is this Michael? Daniel chapter 10 verse 12 to 13, and if you read, it makes the point, then said he unto me, fear not. Daniel was praying for 3 weeks. The prayer was not be answered. Could it be sometimes you pray and yet you receive not your requests because there were some factors? The Bible says, from the first day that you set out your heart to understand and to chasten thyself before thy God, thy words were heard, and I come for thy words. Verse 13, but because of the prince of Persia, withstood me 21 days, and behold, Micah, one of the chief princes. In fact, in the Hebrew, in the Aramaic, if you check, it said there. It didn't use a relative. It used a definite article. In the English translation, they just used one of. In the Hebrew, it was the chief priest or princes. He came to help. So instance number one, Revelation 12 verse 7, Micah fought the dragon. Jude 9, Micah contended with the body of Moses. Daniel 10, prayers were withheld, but Michael came for 21 days. Daniel was praying, and it must take the intervention of Michael for prayers to be answered. Tonight I say, may God release a Michael for us. May God send forth a Michael for us, that he will make our request during these 2 weeks be answered in Jesus' name. Michael, who is this Michael? Ladies and gentlemen, Daniel chapter 10, verse 20 to verse 21. Then said he, knowest thou wherefore I come unto thee? And now I will return to fight with the prince of Persia. It is mentioned again. And when I am gone forth, lo, the prince of Greece shall come. Verse 21, but I will shew thee that which is not in scriptures of truth, that there is none. Thou holdest me in these things, but your Michael, your prince, who was withholding the revelation of the book of Daniel from being interpreted appropriately. It was Satan. You know, they call him the prince of this world. Some say this refers to the leader of Persia. No, he's the king of Persia. But the Bible never says the king of Persia withstood me. He said the prince of Persia. Satan, in Ephesians 2 verse 2, he talks about Satan being the prince of this world. In John 12 verse 31, now is the judgment of this world. Now shall the prince of this world, Satan, is the prince of this world. But the Bible says there is always a fight in the book of Daniel, in the book of Revelation, between Michael and between the dragon. Ladies and gentlemen, in Daniel 12 verse 1, it says, and at that time Michael shall stand up. I love this. In Daniel chapter 7 verse 1, the old man, God the Father, was seated with Jesus on his hand side. But in Daniel 12 verse 1, they said Michael stood, he shall stand up, that great prince which standeth for the church.